You hear a lot about RVing mistakes, but in today's video, we're gonna share 10 that can turn your fun family adventure into a deadly RV trip. Here are our top 10 deadly RV mistakes.
Welcome back to the RV Odd Couple. My name is John.
And I'm Mercedes. We RV pursuing freedom, independence, and adventure.
Because life is so short, guys.
It is. And in this video, we're going to warn you about mistakes that we see people making all the time.
Some of these mistakes, two of them actually, we've made ourselves. And we know we're going to take a lot of heat in the comment section, but we tell it like it is, guys. And these are mistakes that, as newbies, everybody should be aware of. And the last three that we're going to talk about are the most deadliest things when it comes to RVing, so stay tuned for that.
So number one is not knowing your RV, and this can take many different forms. Not knowing your height, not knowing your weight, and not knowing how you should distribute your weight are deadly mistakes to make while RVing.
So make sure you actually jump out. We've jumped out and measured from the ground to the highest point of our RV so that we know in our heads the height of our RV. As you travel, you will see yellow warning signs telling you what the height of a bridge is or a low clearance area. So know your RV. It amazes me that we drive around and we'll ask somebody, what's the height of your RV? And they won't know the answer to that. These are things you need to know. There's also a bunch of apps out there that you can load it in. We tried Copilot. We had a horrible experience with Copilot. We are in the process of trying to find a good navigation app for RVers where you can put in the height and the weight.
So if you have any suggestions, please let us know in the comments, because what we've been doing is sticking to major highways to avoid those low bridges. The next big piece is the weight. You know, the manufacturer will tell you how much weight you can add to the contents of your RV.
This is really easy to locate. There will be a sticker on everybody's RV that will tell you the allowable weight and contents that you can place in your rig. Make sure you know what that is. And also, always try to distribute that weight more to the front of the rig and not the back of the rig. You can run into serious problems when you overweigh the back of an RV, whether it's a fifth wheel or a travel trailer. So obviously, when you're setting out and you're brand new, you get everything you think you need in your RV, go to a CAT scale, get weighed, and know whereabouts you are.
Number two is not monitoring your tires properly.
Yeah, more accidents happen because of tire blowouts than anything else when it comes to RVing pulling trailers, guys. We use the tire minder. You should always know what your pressure is and what the heat on those tires are when you're traveling. Underinflated tires or overinflated tires can cause big problems. So do yourself and your family a big favor. Invest in a TPMS. So what I do before every trip, I'll rotate through my tires on the rig and also in my truck. And I want to get that pressure exactly what the cold pressure rating of those tires is.
And even though you can invest in a manual tire pressure system and manually checking it is better than nothing, what worries us is that if you're driving and you have a slow leak, or if the temperature in one tire is getting really hot and you don't know because you've been driving for hours, it's better to have a system that monitors the tires while you're driving and relays the information while you're in the driver's seat, so you know at any given moment how your tires are doing. Checking the tires leads to the third deadliest mistake, and that is speeding. Many people don't realize, but your tires aren't just rated for weight, they're also rated for speed. So just because your tires are fit to hold the weight of your RV doesn't mean they're fit to hold the weight of the RV at 90 miles an hour.
Exactly, and you can find on the sidewall of each tire all the specs, the cold pressure that you need to have them adjusted to, also the speed rating. Most RV tires are between 55 and 65. It absolutely blows me away by how many times we've driven down the highway and we'll see people that are in 12-ton rigs fly by us at 80, 85 miles per hour. When something goes wrong with a 12-ton rig, it happens fast.
So there's no excuse for speeding. You should never be in a hurry when you're driving your RV. The fourth deadly mistake that people make all the time is driving while fatigued. Especially when you're traveling long distances, it can be really fatiguing when you have travel days that are back to back of one another. Not taking a break between travel days will add to the exhaustion.
Yeah, and when I was a younger man, I could travel 24, 30 hours straight without sleeping, right? It's not the case anymore. And so I've got to get a good night's rest before I have a travel day. If I start to feel tired, it's time to stop. our rule for 2020, and I hope we can stick to it, is no more than 300 miles or 5 hours driving. It's going to be a little bit different for everybody. I'm comfortable with that.
Every time you see a rest stop, it's good to stop, stretch your legs, go to the restroom.
Do a walk around, check your lug nuts.
So because of that, it actually takes a lot longer than it would in a car to drive the same distance.
Yep, so get rest and take your time. Now this next one I've never heard anybody talk about, but it's a serious problem. Septic gases are a serious issue when it comes to RVers. Now, obviously you keep your black tank closed until it's completely full and then you can drain that down. But most RVers will leave their gray and their galleys open. We do.
Yeah.
Just make sure that you put a P-trap in that hose so that septic gases that are in the septic system or the sewer system that you're dumping into do not come back up into the rig. Obviously, sometimes you can smell it, but septic gases can also not smell, and they're not good for your lungs. So make sure you have a P-trap on all your open sewer lines.
Number six is not maintaining the vehicle you're pulling with. It's easy to focus on the RV's tires, but don't neglect the tires of your pulling vehicle. Both vehicles need to be operating in optimal condition.
Make sure your vehicle is properly rated to tow the RV that you're pulling. Nowadays with RVs, they are 3, 4, 5 times heavier than your pull vehicle.
It's really scary when you see a big old RV that's like 4 times the size of a little tiny truck, and you can see the back end of the truck really low.
It's so important, not only for pulling that rig, more importantly, for stopping that rig that you're pulling. Mm-hmm. Make sure you have proper maintenance on that tow vehicle. Checking your oil, checking your tires, tire wear, brakes. All of these things are so important, because if anything does go wrong with the RV, the vehicle that you have to stop the RV is your pull truck.
Number seven is not having a proper safety kit. And you would be shocked at how many people don't consider this. When I first told John that I wanted him to get this bright looking thing,
it's like, I don't need that.
He thought it was absolutely ridiculous. And I know you macho men don't want to wear this like strapping vest, but I tell you what, this has come in handy. When we had to pull over on the side of the road and all those cars were flying right past him, he was grateful that he had something so he could stand out.
Right, there's been two occasions where I had to pull off the highway. And guys, I'll tell you, you don't know what that's like until you actually experience it. Sometimes you cannot get that far into the breakdown lane. There's not enough shoulder there to allow you to do that. So it's so, so important that you have a safety kit with you. You want to have safety cones. You want to have safety lights. Mm-hmm. Obviously, you want to have a reflective vest. It's so that other drivers can see you. We carry a fire extinguisher in our truck, and this isn't only for our safety, but if we ever come up upon a driver who is in trouble, whether they have a fire or they need help, we can pull over and help our neighbor get them out of the car. This will actually cut seatbelts and break a window, so that it makes Mercedes and I more effective at being good neighbors and being able to help another when we can. I actually use these. There's been a few times we pull into the RV park later and it's dark out, and I use these little flashers to kind of give me a runway of how to approach backing my rig in.
Don't skimp on safety. Hopefully you never have to use this. There are alternative uses for these items, and you don't want to be wishing you had this, especially when you're in the dark.
Obviously, you always want to have a spare tire, which we do. You want to have the appropriate tools to change that tire. There are some times where you should not be trying to change a tire if you just can't get off the shoulder and you're too close to traffic. So we will highly suggest to purchase tow insurance.
Yeah.
Those guys have all the equipment they need to properly do this as quick as they can.
And we've actually had to use them before. They were a total lifesaver.
And the last three are probably the biggest dangers when you're RVing. And since we've begun RVing, we've seen some horrible things on the news. And we were absolutely blown away by how fast these rigs will go up in flames, how quickly that can happen. So you want to have a fire extinguisher, and we like to have two in the RV, one near each exit. The most important thing when it comes to a fire or the threat of fire is to get as much warning as you possibly can. And so our RV came with one smoke detector. We went ahead and added an additional smoke detector in the bedroom. Time matters when it comes to fire. You need to get your family exited out of the vehicle as fast as you possibly can. The next piece is always have a plan. Mercedes and I actually practice our escape routes if there were to be a fire. Every RV has emergency exits in it, and have a plan for your family to escape. You're also gonna wanna have a CO2 alarm. Most new rigs come with CO2 alarms. It's located in the kitchen. You don't wanna be sleeping and have a gas leak, not get a warning for your family to exit the vehicle as soon as possible.
Yeah, because you can't smell that necessarily, so that's pretty scary.
A spike in an RV resort's power system can fry your wires and start a fire. So an RV surge protector is gonna help not only protect all your components and your wiring, but it's also gonna protect you from a possible fire. Now in the RV space, different people are gonna have different solutions to get heat. The most expensive way to heat these RVs is with your propane and the built-in HVAC system, right? So what we've done for our solution is we use ceramic heaters. Now the ceramic heaters we purchase have a tip over mechanism. So if they tip over, it will immediately shut off. Also, what people don't realize is those little electric heaters that you plug in really heat up the wire that's running to the plug. So you gotta be super, super careful. Next time you run your electric ceramic heater, just go over and pick that line up and you'll notice it's really warm. Just imagine what the lines in the walls are doing.
Yeah, and make sure you're not overloading your electrical capabilities, is that what you would say? If you plug in too many heaters in the wrong place, you could be putting your electrical system in grave danger.
If you're gonna use two ceramic heaters, you're gonna wanna put them on different circuits. The other thing we see some people do that we decided not to do is actually having a propane or a kerosene heater in an RV. Those just scare me because of the CO2 that comes off, and the fire danger is just through the roof. We know there's safe ways to do it, but we always err on the side of caution. Another really good tip to avoid fire is when you're moving your RV, make sure you turn your propane tanks to the off position. Typically on these RVs, the propane lines run under the RV. Anything can kick up off the ground and actually put a leak in that. So to avoid fire, just go ahead and turn off your propane tanks while you're moving your RV.
Number 9 is not having a way to protect your family. There's a spectrum of RVers. You have some RVers that like to boondock and other RVers that like to stay in RV parks. We like to stay in RV parks, and we have had safety and security issues, and there's other people around. We cannot even begin to imagine what it would be like to boondock in the middle of nowhere and to have someone try to get in the RV or try to intimidate you.
When we did our 911 video on this, our experience when we had attackers on the outside of the RV, we had a ton of people send us emails and make comments in that video of how they were in the middle of nowhere and were harassed or had somebody trying to get into the RV. It's so important, it's paramount that you have the tools necessary to protect you and your family when you are on the road RVing.
Unfortunately, last year there were a couple of RVers that were found murdered. They typically boondocked, so we're not making this up. You have to consider your safety, especially when you're mobile, because different places are safer than others, and you don't necessarily know how safe your location is.
We have all the tools necessary, and more importantly, a plan for just about anything that can happen to us, whether it's fire or personal safety from an intruder. We have a plan, and we know exactly what each of our job is to protect our family and our RV.
So number 10 is being distracted, and this has caused us to make a couple of really dangerous and embarrassing mistakes that could have been deadly.
When you are preparing your rig to move, it's so important that you stay focused and you have a checklist of what you need to do to safely move your rig from the location you're at to the location that you are trying to get to. And so you really need to stay focused on the task at hand. One of the things that I made a big, big mistake on early on is when I would start to clean up and get ready to move our rig, I'm a friendly person, and so people would approach me and start talking to me, and I would stop what I was doing and I'd start talking to people, but I'd lose track of where I was in my process when I close up shop and get ready to move our rig. And so now what I know is that if somebody approaches me, especially while I'm connecting the truck, I tell them, listen, I've really got to focus at the task at hand, and I'd be happy to talk to you later.
And most people don't get offended at that. In fact, they understand because they know what it's like when you're in the middle of something and you get distracted. But this happened to us one time in California.
And I was actually connecting the truck to my fifth wheel hitch, and I forgot to drop my pin in when I had locked on. And it was because I had made the connection, I had tightened down, but then somebody walked up and started a conversation with me. I jumped down off the truck, I had a 5 or 10 minute conversation, and I forgot. I overlooked putting that safety pin in my locking arm. And I'll tell you, we drove almost 300 miles that day. When we got to that location and I realized the pin wasn't in, my heart dropped, because I thought immediately back to the terrain that we just had traversed earlier that day. And the idea of what could have happened if that rig had come loose could have been devastating, not only to us, but for other travelers that are out there on the road.
Whether you're a new RVer or you're an experienced RVer, being distracted when performing these tasks is so dangerous. Another form of distraction that we have dealt with a lot is when you're driving to a new area and you're seeing something beautiful for the first time. You know, John, as the driver, doesn't get to look like I do as the passenger. And it creates a situation where he's trying to look at this beautiful stuff that he's never seen before. And he's telling me, look, look. And I'm freaking out because I'm looking at him not looking.
And I'm mad at her because she's not taking video, but she's busy looking at me to make sure I don't take my eye off the road. We were traveling over this gorgeous bridge in a city that we had never been to before. And I was watching out on the river in the city that we were going into. And I wasn't paying attention to the traffic in front of me. And when I turned around, there was brake lights, and I have a 12-ton vehicle. So I learned a very valuable lesson to always have my head on a swivel when I'm driving my family. My job as the driver is to be safe and to not harm ourselves or others.
Sorry, Mom, if you're watching, but we're showing that so that you know how easily it is to get distracted and how important it is to just keep your eye on the road. So you might be thinking, come on guys, this is a really scary topic, don't scare us. Well, we had a situation that was absolutely terrifying where we had people attacking the RV and we couldn't call 911. In the next video, we'll tell you all about it and give you more specifics on how to handle a situation like that more safely.
We'll see you in the next video, guys.